This week on Maker Update, a fanny pack with all the hacks, a violin that doesn't stop, RGB wood paneling, and 3D printed designs for 16th century technology. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we keep you up to date on all the wonderful things that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. We've got a really fun show for you, so let's check out the project of the week. Fanny packs haven't had the easiest journey through history. Having a compact bag on your person for accessories and small items has always been a good idea, but they've always seemed a little, you know. But they've had a bit of a glow up in the past few years, and Laura Kampf just gave them a heck of an upgrade by integrating a tool roll into this carry-all classic. The idea for this pack came about because Laura loves to scavenge stuff when she goes for walks. But instead of hauling the whole carcass back to her shop, she prefers to take it apart in situ, which means she needs a place for tools she might need for any disassembly. She also needs a place to store the scavenged bits, and since they're road finds, they might be filthy, so it's a good idea to keep them clear from the tool storage. The resulting design looks sort of like a mini messenger bag, but it wears like a fanny pack. The top flap works as a tool roll, which keeps your tools separate from the storage compartment. Plus, there's some additional pockets to keep other tools close to hand, like pens or knives or whatever you need. There's even a strong magnet integrated into the strap to hold other tools for easy access. The design of this bag was done in collaboration with Mafia Bags in San Francisco, who also have a strong ethos in using recycled and reclaimed materials like sailcloth. It looks like they're also the manufacturer of the Savage Industries bag. But this could be so much more than Laura's intended use case, and is ripe for people to find their own utility with it. Laura is looking at a few options to do a limited product run of this bag, so keep an eye on her channels if you want to get one for yourself. More projects. Through Hackaday, I learned about this 3D printed 8-shaft table loom by Fraens. This is a blend of traditional weaving technology with modern sensibility, making the ability to create complex weaving patterns fairly accessible to newcomers, as long as they're willing to put in the time to learn. There's a lot of parts to print, but it all looks like it should be printable on even a modest-sized print bed. And all the rest of the hardware looks like you could pick it up at your local hardware supplier. The video is fantastic. It takes you all the way through the building process of assembling the loom from the printed parts, the setup, and a brief demonstration video of how it works. What's more, he also tells you how to interpret weave patterns you can find on the internet and turn them into instructions you can execute on this loom. Fraens makes the files available on his Cult 3D page, and while it isn't free, it's not a bad way to get into this new means of expression. I was fascinated to see this fully mechanical game of Snake made out of Lego by Ozzie Gerff. If you never had a Nokia phone, this is a game where you navigate a board, eating food to grow longer, and making sure you never crash into your own body. In this case, every single part of the game, the input, the logic, the computer, and the display is entirely mechanical and built from Lego. Fair warning, this project isn't done yet, and he still needs to figure out how to create the logic for the game end. But he takes you through every step of the game so far, and it's impressive. It also might be the world's first entirely mechanical display, but I'll let the experts comment on that. And from Xyla Foxlin, she's worked out a project that she's had in her head for a few years now, a violin that incorporates a Mobius strip into its design. This is going to be an electric violin, which allows her to do this radical design idea. The outer body is a CNC machine strip of maple that creates the necessary curve, and the neck that holds all the vital components. It's a gorgeous design and brilliant all on its own. But Xyla also consults with a local violin luthier to consult on finishing it. There's this YouTube idea that if you don't do anything yourself, you're a failure. But stuff that. You should always ask for help with your projects when you need it, and you should include other people in the stories you tell. And the end result sounds as gorgeous as it looks. Time for some tips and tools. You've probably heard of magnetic twist locks, that let you hold work with a twist of the fixture and then release it when you twist it back. Andrew Klein has a design for how to 3D print your own. Of course, you'll need to add some magnets of your own, as well as some steel rod, but he also takes some time to explain how they work. Zack Freedman went on a recent tear of making a new PC that included as much RGB as a PC could handle, and then added some more. But he did us the favor of including the best tip right in the video thumbnail: how to make wood that is illuminated with beautiful color. The trick here is the aluminum C-channel used to house the LED strip, and then wrapping the whole thing, including the diffusion, in wood edge banding. It's a cool looking technique. It looks like elegant wood rods when they aren't lit up, but when they are, they look like wildly glowing strips of hardwood. Unsatisfied by other shop tool hanging techniques, April Wilkerson has a new design she's calling Slot 45, and it's pretty easy to do on your own. All you need to do is cut a series of 45 degree angle cuts into your backing wood, and then a single corresponding slot in your hanger piece. Then just glue a piece of material that fits into the slot, and you're done. This seems like it could be adaptable to any shop, so maybe give it a try. And from PBS, we have a very long video about the history of the telescope. You might be turned off by the runtime, but that's okay. This is a big story to tell. Stick around for this one because you'll get to learn about the early observation of the night sky, the creation of clear glass, and the invention of some of the first stellar observation tools ever created. This is the incredible story of photographers, astronomers, and inventors. Don't miss it. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we've got this primer on how to calculate the proper trace width for your PCB design. Dependent on the expected current load of the trace, you can anticipate a proper width to ensure it doesn't interfere with other neighboring traces. This width value can also vary depending on if it's a surface trace or an internal trace. You can get all the details from the DigiKey video. Check it out. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. As always, you can get more info about every single one of these projects by following the links down in the description. While you're there, be sure to give us a comment, give us a thumbs up, and hit subscribe so you won't miss the next one. As always, great big thanks to DigiKey for making the whole show possible, and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.